This is the story of 12-year-old Johnny Gosch, who was abducted in the middle of his paper route. But this wasn't any old kidnapping. It's the most infamous case in Iowa history, with allegations of elite pedophile rings involving the Reagan-Bush administration and an alleged cover-up by the highest-ranking government officials in the media. It's a case that's still unsolved today. The question isn't just where Johnny is, but who took him? And why? There's an adult content warning for this episode. I'm Alex Clark, and this is Paper Boys, Presidents and Pedophiles, The Johnny Gosch Story, Part 1. It hadn't quite hit crisp fall temperatures yet in the early morning hours of West Des Moines, Iowa, on September 5th, 1982. 12-year-old Johnny Gosch wakes up before dawn to start his paper route around his neighborhood. For over 13 months, Johnny woke his dad, John, up to go with him every morning. But this time, Johnny decides to let his parents sleep in and takes his wiener dog, Gretchen, in his red wagon that he uses to deliver his papers in. About a block from Johnny's house, other kids doing their own paper routes see a man driving a blue two-toned Ford Fairmont with Nebraska plates. The car stops and asks Johnny for directions. After speaking to the man for a few seconds, Johnny walks away and the blue car does an immediate U-turn towards the other kids. The man opens his door and starts to talk to them with slurred speech. And Johnny basically says, "Something is not right here. This dude is nuts. I'm leaving," like the king he was. As Johnny walks away, the man in the car slams his door shut, starts the engine, and clicks the inside light on and off 3 times. Suddenly, another man appears, emerging from the bushes, and follows quietly about a half a block behind 12-year-old Johnny Gosch. An eyewitness describes seeing the man follow Johnny around a corner out of sight, hearing a car door slam, the screeching of tires, and then the same blue Ford Fairmont appeared again, ran a stop sign, and turned north towards the interstate. Back at home, Johnny's parents, John and Noreen Gosch, awake to phone calls from neighbors complaining that they haven't received their papers. Johnny's dad jumps out of bed and tells Noreen that Johnny must be running late, so he's going to go help him. It only takes a few minutes for John to bust through the front door screaming for Noreen to call the police immediately. Johnny's gone. Somebody took him. Johnny's dad sees his wagon sitting abandoned on the street corner full of newspapers. It takes the police 45 minutes to show up. Even though the police don't seem to have a fire under them, Noreen sure does. She doesn't waste any time calling everyone she knows whose child was on that street corner with Johnny. By the time the police show up, Noreen has a full description of the man, the car, and a partial license plate number. Police insinuate that maybe Johnny has just run away, even though he has no history of doing so, and despite there being multiple witnesses who saw the strange man in the car talking to Johnny. The officer gets annoyed and leaves, while Johnny's parents wait with zero help until after 3 p.m. So what do Noreen and John do? They take things into their own hands and contact the media and put together search parties. While neighbors are searching one of the state parks, the police chief gets on top of a picnic table drunk with a megaphone and tells everyone to go home because Johnny Gosch is nothing but a damn runaway. He won't last long as police chief and will later be caught shoplifting. With no help from the local police, Noreen turns to the FBI, who says they don't want to get involved because there was no crime. When Noreen points out that she has no son, they say that the police chief said this case doesn't require the FBI and that they are not to get involved. Even with wall-to-wall coverage from the media, the police refused to act. 9 agonizing years pass, and a young guy by the name of Paul Benassi is sitting in jail. He was a victim himself of a prostitution ring as a boy, and so he tells his attorney that he was involved in the Johnny Gosch kidnapping. Not only that, but Paul says that a prominent conservative politician and credit union owner from Omaha, Nebraska named Larry King is involved as well. Not to be confused with the broadcaster Larry King. At the time, Omaha's Larry King was the fastest growing African-American African-American man in the conservative movement. He even sang the Star-Spangled Banner at the Republican National Convention in 1984 and 1988. Outside of politics, Larry King runs a credit union, which ends up getting raided by federal officials on Election Day 1988. The $2 million credit union had a secret stash of books that showed another $40 million had come in from all kinds of random places. Some of the biggest corporations in America, and a nonprofit still around today called Boys Town that helps children dealing with neglect, abuse, or behavioral issues.
A place where homeless, neglected, and unloved boys could find the day-to-day affection, care, and companionship summed up in the word home.
Larry plays dumb and acts like he has no idea he even had all this extra money. As law enforcement starts looking into him, very weird stories start to emerge that get louder and louder. Larry King is accused by several children of running a massive elite pedophile ring that involves some of the biggest names in law enforcement, the FBI, and politics. Former conservative Nebraska State Senator John DeCamp is on the trail. He knows that the only way to get an elite pedophile ring exposed because of the high-level people involved is to get the media so into it that there's no way it can be ignored. So DeCamp writes a book that details the entire thing from beginning to end called The Franklin Cover-Up. It takes 8 years for the Nebraska legislature to investigate the shady business allegedly taking place at the Franklin Credit Union, where they found multiple child witnesses claiming they had been trafficked by Larry King. Many of them had gone to Boys Town. One of the accusers is a young man by the name of Paul Benassi. Paul claims that he had been abducted into the pedophile ring himself when he was little and had seen multiple prominent figures at parties he and other boys were forced to go to. One of the names he drops? George Bush Sr. According to Paul Benassi, at the time, Vice President Bush attended 3 to 4 pedophile parties and that on 2 separate occasions, he watched 2 different boys perform oral sex on him. Now, no one really ever believed Paul Benassi. He had been arrested by police the night the credit union got raided for allegedly molesting his own cousin. So he writes a letter to Senator John DeCamp and says, "If you come visit me in jail, I can prove to you that everything I'm saying is true." John DeCamp goes to the jail, and as he's walking in, the psychologist there to interview Paul Benassi is walking out. DeCamp takes the opportunity and says, "So everything this guy is claiming is crazy, right? There's no truth to any of this?" And the psychologist says, "Not only is he telling the truth, he's incapable of lying. He has multiple personalities, so he just switches personalities and that other personality will say what they know." DeCamp is blown away by this. He walks in to visit with Benassi, and Benassi tells him, "I've kept a diary every day since I was little. It's hiding in such and such spot in this house. Go get it and read it all for yourself." John DeCamp has this diary forensically analyzed by 2 separate organizations to determine the age of the ink and to make sure this wasn't all written the day before or anything. And they confirm that it was in fact written during the time frame Benassi claimed it was. Naturally, the next person that needs to vet Benassi is Johnny's mom, Noreen. Paul tells her things about the case that she had discovered early on and purposely kept from the police so that she would know if a suspect was telling the truth about being involved in her son's case. After Benassi's testimony, a list of over 240 potential victims of this pedophile ring are sent to state investigators. One of the private investigators involved is a man named Gary Caradori. He comes across someone claiming to have dozens of photos of boys being abused at Larry King's parties. But before he can share them with the public, Caradori is involved in a private plane crash with his 8-year-old son. People close to him believe it was murder because he may have had substantial evidence in the plane. Then, 15 years after 12-year-old Johnny disappears, Noreen Gosh hears a knock at her front door in the middle of the night. Could it be Johnny? Find out tomorrow at 4 p.m. Eastern, 1 p.m. Pacific for part 2 of Paper Boys, Presidents, and Pedophiles, the Johnny Gosch story.